So we have this strong form of weighted residual statement, and including both domain residual and the boundary residual, and weighted sum of all the errors should obviously vanish for any workable approximation. And this weighted residual statement can be converted into weak form by trading the derivatives between the governing differential equation or the domain residual term and the weighting function term. So we have the boundary term. In the case of one dimensional problem, this becomes a simple integration by parts. So we have a boundary term here, and this derivative shifts to the differential, the weighting function. So we have dw by dx multiplied by a times d phi by dx and integrated over the domain x ranging from 0 to L. And other terms are just the domain integrals, standard domain integrals, and this is the boundary integral term, boundary residual. So looking at the boundary term, we identify, substitute phi in terms of w, and we identify that the primary variable is phi, and approximation phi hat shall be an interpolation between the values of phi at nodes which define finite elements. Now when I say the interpolation is in terms of the primary variable, then obviously the nodes are shared by the adjacent elements. Elements are defined by the nodes. We saw that in the earlier slide, the one-dimensional element, linear element is defined by two nodes at the endpoints of the straight line. A quadratic element is defined by three nodes, two nodes at the endpoint, and one node can be anywhere in the interior, and so on. Right. So at the extremes, there are always going to be nodes, and the primary variable is defined at that node, or is considered. I mean, the primary variable is defined as a constant at that node, and unknown constant, and variation within the element is defined as the interpolation between the values of primary variable at those nodes. Right. So in this particular example, the primary variable appears, the unknown of the problem, phi, zeroth order derivative of that unknown is the primary variable. And the continuity of primary variable is ensured by virtue of interpolation model. So if the same variable is being interpolated at the node which is shared by two adjacent elements, then obviously the continuity of a primary variable is ensured by virtue of the interpolation theory. So the approximation will of course agree with the function value at that node. So wherever that node is, whether it we approach that node from element 1 or whether you approach that node from element number 2, as long as that node is shared by the two elements, the value of the primary variable at that node is going to be same. So this is zeroth order derivative, that is continuous across the element boundaries, and therefore these elements we will discuss are referred to as C0 continuous elements. So interpolation in terms of phi ensures continuity of the approximation phi hat across element boundaries sharing common nodes for interpolation. Right? So the highest order of derivative in the weak form is 1, and therefore the approximation should be a complete polynomial. This is important. The approximation should be a complete polynomial at least up to first degree. So what do we mean by a complete polynomial? First degree, we understand first degree is of course one dimension, it's going to be x. So if I just say that approximation is phi hat is equal to x, is it enough? Does it make it complete polynomial? Any ideas? Is it a complete polynomial up to first degree? If I just say phi hat is
equal to C0 plus C1x, na, then it will be complete.
No, C1 is of course constant, unknown cost constant. So even if I say C1x, so let's say C1x, so is it a complete polynomial?
C0 plus C1x.
C0. So the complete polynomial requires all lower order terms up to the highest degree that is required. Right? So if the requirement is highest order derivative is 1, so the highest order derivative should exist, so at least a linear term should exist. So it means complete polynomial would require all lower degree terms up to first degree. So in this case, the lower degree term would be just a constant, zeroth order derivative. So the approximation phi hat should be equal to a constant term plus a linear term. That is the complete first degree polynomial. Right? And that is what the approximation is required. A first degree polynomial interpolation within a subdomain requires two nodes with one value of primary variable phi at each node. So the polynomial model of interpolation, so a0 plus a1x, that is the complete polynomial that we need to have in within one element, and that polynomial can be represented as interpolation between two nodal values. So phi defined at node 1 and phi defined at node 2. So that is defined as phi 1 and phi 2. And associated with each of these nodes 1 and 2 are functions that are called the interpolation functions, such that the approximation can be constructed, phi hat can be constructed as phi 1 n1 x plus phi 2 n2 of x. N1 and n2 are the interpolation functions associated with node 1 and node 2 respectively. Right? So we have already looked at the interpolation functions, what they are and how do they work. We will again look at the interpolation theory closely in this development. But you should appreciate that the polynomial remains the same. There are different ways of writing the same polynomial. So even if I write it in terms of interpolation function, essentially if I gather all the terms, it can always be converted to this standard form, a0 plus a1x. So the polynomial remains a linear polynomial, and a first degree polynomial passing through two points is a unique variation. I can split the terms, I can write it in different formats, but it doesn't change the function as such. So continuity of zeroth order derivative is preserved across the element boundaries because these primary variables which are being interpolated, they are zeroth order derivatives of the unknown, and therefore zeroth order derivative is continuous across the element boundaries, and this is referred to as C0 continuity. And the finite elements that we will be developing now, they are referred to as finite elements of C0 continuity, and in one dimension. Of course, we are at the moment we are concentrating only on one dimension, and the approximation phi hat is piecewise continuous over the total domain. So it is continuous. I mean, this linear term, linear variation, is of course defined over each one particular element, and there will be another linear variation over another element. So linear variation over one element and linear variation over another element. So the variation can be different, but the at the common node, the primary variable is going to be shared. So it is going to be continuous, the function approximation is going to be continuous, but it is going to be piecewise continuous in the sense that slope over slope of the variation over each element is not guaranteed to be identical. So while the rate of change of variation, I mean d phi by dx in one element might be something, d phi by dx in the adjacent element might be something else. So the gradients are not continuous, because that is not the way the entire formulation is developed. The formulation is developed only to ensure the continuity of the primary variable, that is zeroth order derivative of the unknown function. Right, and that ensures approximation to be piecewise continuous over individual elements. And to define this, we have a graphical representation of the problem that we, the governing differential equation that we have. So this is the uniform bar subjected to traction, surface traction Q, and the end load Q0, which is defined equal to A times d phi by dx at x is equal to L. And x is being measured from the left hand side support. Right. So the first step that we need to do here is divide the domain. So this is the physical system, total model. We divide this into four finite elements. So this is element number one under the square boxes, numbers under the square boxes. So element number one, it is defined by this segment, this line segment between, defined by the nodes 1 and 2. So these are the nodes. So the element number 1 is defined by nodes 1 and 2. Element number 2 is defined by nodes 2 and 3. Element number 3 is defined by nodes 3 and 4. And finally, element number 4 is defined by nodes 4 and 5. So individually, they are all independent elements. So I can be generally talking only in terms of one generic element defined by two nodes, let's say I and J, left hand side node I, right hand side node J, for any element, generic element E, right? And the formulation can be developed in a general sense. And the nodes are, what is the difference between these nodes? The entire problem is, of course, uniform, and material properties are uniform, everything is identical. So what is the distinction between these nodes or different elements? Can you identify?
Sir, node 1 and 5 are supported by the boundary conditions, unlike node 2, 3, 4.
Yes, node 1 and 5, they coincide with the boundaries of the problem. So that is fine. But what is what I wanted to hear was, these nodes are defined by their coordinates individually. So node 1 has coordinate x is equal to 0. Node 2 has a coordinate something, let's say L is equal to L by 4. Node 3 has a coordinate L by 2. Node 4 has a coordinate 3L by 4. And node 5 has a coordinate x is equal to L. So it is the coordinates which define the position of these nodes in the domain omega. And the element is defined by two nodes, whatever the two nodes are. So element number 1 is defined by the nodes at the positions of x is equal to 0 and at the position of x is equal to L by 4, that is node 2. Right? And why is this important? Because this will affect, I mean, the coordinates will affect the coefficients a0 and a1 that we will construct in the approximation. So approximation will depend on the, what is the position of the node in the space, in the domain. Right? So this is what we have, I mean, the entire, this finite element discretization. This is the graphical representation of the discretization. This entire domain x ranging from 0 to L is discretized into a set of four finite elements. and each of the finite elements is defined by two nodes. Now this is of course graphical representation. Graphical representation doesn't help much in finite element computation. We need to feed information in terms of very structured data, numerical data. So how is this domain decomposition or the mesh discrete finite element mesh discretization of the domain? This process is called discretization of the domain. This continuous segment from x ranging from 0 to L is converted into discrete segments, x ranging from x1 to x2, x ranging from x2 to x3, x ranging from x3 to x4, and x ranging from x4 to x5. Right, so this is called discretization, and this discretization data needs to be stored in a structured form which can be accessible during easily retrieved from the for computer implementation. So that is done by using what we call as nodal connectivity of finite element mesh. So essentially we identify that the entire domain 0 to L is discretized by using four elements, and each element is identified by a number, element 1, element 2, element 3, element 4, and element 1 is identified by two extreme nodes, right? And the left hand side node is referred to as node I, and right hand side node is referred to as node J, generic representation. So for element 1, left hand side node is node 1 and right hand side node is node 2. And these nodes are defined by the coordinates. So the coordinate of node 1 is 0, coordinate of node 2 is L by 4. And the length of the element is of course in this case just the difference between these two coordinates. So length of the element is L by 4. Next we go to element 2. Element 2 is defined by two nodes again, but the left hand side node for element 2 is now node 2, isn't it? So element 2 is defined by left hand side node 2 and right hand side node 3, and that is what is referred here. Element 2 is defined by node ith node as 2 and jth node as 3, and node 2 and node 3 are defined by its their coordinates L by 4 and L by 2. And the length of the element is again L by 4, difference between these coordinates. Similarly, node 3 is defined by, element 3 is defined by node 3 and node 4. Length of the element is again L by 4. Element number 4 is defined by node 4 and node 5. The coordinates are 3L by 4 and L, and length of the element is again L by 4. So, we have accomplished the first task of the finite element analysis, that is we have been able to divide the domain, problem domain, into non-overlapping subdomains. Do you recall the domain decomposition omega was given as union of omega e, individual subdomain. Omega e was required to be non-overlapping, and that is what is done here. So entire domain omega, that is x ranging from 0 to L, is now represented as union of individual subdomain omega 1, omega 2, omega 3, omega 4, right? And the total union of these four subdomains is equal to the original domain L, 0 to L. And the approximate solution over the whole domain is constructed in piecewise manner by constructing independent approximations over each element. So now we will construct approximations over each of the elements independently. So we will construct approximation for phi over element 1, which is of course dependent only on the values of phi at node 1 and node 2. We will construct approximation over element 2 based on interpolation between function value at node 2 and node 3, and so on for element 3 and element 4. Element 4, it will be interpolation between phi 4 and phi 5. The approximation within an element is an interpolation between primary variables at the nodes, as we discussed. So what is the representation? So let us now talk about a generic element. Right? As I said, the elements are very much identical, I mean, in nature. They are defined, element E, generic element E is defined by a left side node, let's say ith node, and element J, right hand side node, is defined by node J. And these nodes are characterized by their coordinates, positions in the domain. So node I is defined by coordinate xi, node J is defined by coordinate xj. And the interpolation condition, obviously we know the interpolation condition, that interpolation function for node I should evaluate to unity at node I at xj, xi, and it should vanish at xj. So this should be the variation of ni. So when ni, when evaluated at node I, it should evaluate to unity and it should vanish to 0 at node j. Similarly, interpolation function corresponding to node j should evaluate to 0 at node I, but it should evaluate to unity at node j. Right? So this is the variation that nj should have. Now you can obviously find it out, I mean, you know the, it's an equation of straight line. You can find out the value of the equation of the straight line as a function ni, and equation of this straight line as a function nj, if you know what are the coordinates xi and xj, because these conditions, end conditions, are known. So this is the definition of the element E, node I, node j, and primary variable at node I is referred to as phi I, primary variable at node j is referred to as phi j, and this is of course the assumed positive direction. And then there are secondary variables associated with corresponding nodes. So we have qj and qi, again associated in the positive direction, so there is going to be positive direction, it is minus of a d phi by dx at xi, and at j it is equal to a times d phi by dx, evaluated at node j. So phi is the primary variable and a times d phi by dx is the secondary variable. So both the terms exist, of course, but prescription can only be in terms of one of the two. So variation of primary variable phi within an element defined by the end nodes I and j is given by this summation phi I ni plus phi j nj. And because there are only two values, so this can only be a first degree polynomial. So this is equal to a0 plus a1x. Right? So now we can substitute this and evaluate this approximation. Phi hat should evaluate to phi I when this approximation is evaluated at xi. So if I substitute here xi, I should get phi I. Similarly, if I substitute in this variation xj, I should get phi j. So when I do that, the polynomial approximation should evaluate to the function values at the nodes of interpolation. So phi I is equal to a0 plus xi a1, phi j should be equal to a0 plus xj a1. And this matrix is of course known, 1 xi, 1 xj, xi, xj are known once the nodes are defined. So this can be inverted and these coefficients a0 and a1 can be referred in terms of phi I and phi j. So I can invert this matrix and a0, a1 can be written as inverse of this coordinate matrix multiplied by the primary variables. And then the approximation is given by polynomial terms, 1x multiplied by a0, a1. So we substitute for a0, a1 as this interpolation, this evaluation in terms of primary variables at the nodes. And when we compare with our interpolation model, this product should correspond to the interpolation functions Ni and Nj, because this term is common, this factor phi I phi j is common here in the two representations. So we have this equivalence, and therefore, I mean, once we substitute and find out this inverse and find out the values, we will find the interpolation functions Ni and Nj as x minus xj divided by xj minus xi, and Nj would be x minus xi divided by xj minus xi. Now these interpolation functions can also be derived by simple Lagrange interpolation. I just wanted to take you through the complete process why this Lagrange interpolation is the correct interpolation model for this problem, and that's why I took it took you through the first principles. What we are looking at is the approximation, and approximation should agree with the primary variables at the nodes, and when we do that and express the approximation in terms of primary variables, what we get as the multiplier of the primary variables are essentially the Lagrange interpolation formulas, Lagrange interpolation for one dimension, I mean linear interpolation. So there is really no need to go through this numerical process of inversion of this matrix. There are easier ways to derive this, and simple Lagrange interpolation model can provide the necessary interpolation functions. So I will stop here. Any questions?